different from it. It is, yes, it is a 2D image, but it is not superimposing any kind of structures. Okay, superimpose, it does not superimpose any kind of structures. So how actually the images are being acquired? The images are being acquired is something like this. There is an X-ray tube. Okay, first let us try to observe the parts of a CT machine, then I will get more deeper. Just wait. Okay, see along this one here, this is a one of the classical CT machines that we see in the modern X-ray department these days. Okay, right, the thing is that here the CT machine, every kind of a CT machine has got the two main parts in them. This one is actually called as a gantry. Okay, we have got a CT gantry, right, this circular structure, and that is super embedded in the rectangular or the square kind of a large box like thing. So this one is actually called as gantry. And when you actually try to open up this thing, we actually see here as this way. Okay, we have got the X-ray tube. Okay, here you see here T is called as the X-ray tube, and where X indicates the release of X-rays. Okay, so this is the X-ray tube, the same kind of X-ray tube that is actually being used in a conventional radiography, that is actually being placed here. And then on the opposite side, on the other end where the X-rays pass on, we have got X-ray detectors, same like the electronic panel or the electronic detector that we saw it yesterday on the conventional radiograph. The same thing here. See, until this structure, it is almost same like the conventional radiology equipment itself. Okay, we got an X-ray tube, and the X-rays actually come out here, and then they fall onto the X-ray detector, right? But there is another structure that is actually called as the rotating gantry. Okay, rotating gantry. What actually this does is that it completely revolves this X-ray tube into around 180 degrees. Generally, it might be happening. There are wide varieties, and there are many much advancements in the rotations of the gantries these days. Generally, the most common type of rotation will be actually happening down to 180 degrees. Okay, the CT gantry does not rotate along 360 degrees. Okay, it does not rotate like this. It actually rotates into 180 degrees and then come back to its original position, and then again starts. So this is the first thing. So what happens is that whenever we have an X-ray tube and the body is getting down into the CT machine, we will get one single image. See, it makes a rotation. Okay, it technically makes a rotation. Generally, it will be something around like 270 degrees or 180 degrees. Yes, and some of the advanced machines also does a 360 degrees rotation, a complete rotation out of the body. Then whenever the X-ray rotates, whenever the gantry rotates like this, then it falls onto the detector. The same process but what you have had is the image acquisition. But then this, whatever the signals that has been given down to the detector, will pass onto an A and D converter. And A and D converter, it gets down into a computer. And computer will analyze that image, and it will get into the DA converter. Okay. Then first one, it is get down into AD converter, and from there it gets down into the computer, and computer rearranges them as the DA converter, and from the DA converter the image reconstruction is made. Well, you have to understand what exactly is this image reconstruction. The image reconstruction actually finally comes down onto the screen, and it gives a separate image which is entirely different, which is entirely anatomically different from the image that we actually see on a conventional radiograph. So such kind of a classical reconstruction of the image that is done by the computer is actually called as computed tomography. But logically, the image is also a 2D image that has been obtained here, but the image is showing up as a sliced section of the anatomically oriented organ or the region of interest. Okay, so the difference between a conventional radiograph and a CT scan is that these images are not superimposed. They are not overlapping. In a CT, they are thin sliced sections. Okay. In the CT scan, they are thin sliced sections. So what is the difference between this one 3D into 2D, but this one 3D images into 2D, but in any kind of anatomical plane of interest. In any anatomical plane of interest. So this is the first main difference. Okay, did you understand this? How exactly these things happen? Please respond. The difference between a conventional radiograph and a CT scan is that both of them are 2D images, where a conventional radiograph has got a 3D image that has been superimposed onto a 2D film. Yes, CT scans also, the 3D anatomical region is also superimposed as a 2D image, but in one selective anatomical plane itself. So first, it makes us necessary that we need to try to understand the anatomical planes. Okay, I will come in within a short while, but first we'll complete the other differences, right? And then it gets down into the camera and finally gets down onto the screen, okay? So now, you see, there are different types of CT machines here. You have to understand, CT machines and X-ray, conventional radiograph, both of them use ionizing radiation. Okay, so which means to say, both of these imaging modalities, whenever prescribed, has got their own health hazardous risk, right? Now in this image, you can actually see here, there is some kind of a pencil beam that is being released. Yesterday in conventional radiograph, we see that the X-rays are released down into straight lines. And you see here, every kind of this X-ray that is being released from the X-ray tube is parallel to each other. So such kind of a beam of X-rays is actually called as a pencil beam. And this one will be taken down onto a single detector. So which means to say, the X-rays that are actually falling down longitudinally like this will be taking the image in this plane only, right? That's it. Then what happens is that in the second type of variety of X-ray acquisition or the image acquisition here, there is another type of beam that is actually called as fan beaming. You see here, the X-rays are not parallel to each other, but will be detected by multiple detectors that are present down here. So such kind of fan beaming. So you have to understand here that this is one of the biggest advantages as the CT technology advances. So in a pencil beam, smaller areas are covered, where in a fan beam, there is a larger area that is being covered. See, that is one of the biggest advantage. And at the same point of time, whenever there is a rotation, and the most region and multi-planar imaging or multi-planar imaging, for example, to say sagittal plane, coronal plane, and axial plane are also covered in this way. So the rotation of the gantry that provides the planar, multi-planar imaging, right? You can't see the slides. You can't see the slides. Nobody can see the slides. Okay, just wait. Right. Wait. Okay. Now, can you see it? Yes. Right, the other people. Okay. Right, okay. First, let me come back once again. Okay, here you see here, this is the X-ray tube. The X-ray tube is moving horizontally, right? The X-ray tube is moving horizontally. Now, what happens is that there is the X-rays that are being released are parallel to each other and they are falling down onto a detector. So, which means to say this plane that is being acquired is only the axial plane where the X-rays are cutting down the person down into axial plane itself, in the transverse plane itself. So, the image what we acquired here is just something like an axial plane of a brain. See, we are looking down at the brain axially. Okay, I will get more details of the planes in a short while, but just try to understand. It's same like this. Then once this plane is completely covered from this region to this region, from right side to left side, when this has been completed, the patient will be rotated down in. So this is the bed of the where the patient is positioned, and this bed will be moving inside. Then the next level, something like this. So the images are actually acquired like this and finally comes down into the PAC system and finally comes down into the CT operator console and then finally distributed down into the workstation where the radiologist can see and interpret the images. So this is the most conventional X-ray that is, conventional CT that is available. But in the modern technology, what actually happens is that there are multiple pencil beams. Okay, single X-ray tube is going to release two parallel multiple pencil beams, same like this, and it falls down onto many detectors. And again, this one is also moving horizontally in the plane itself. So this one is covering a smaller in larger time, but these two ones are covering the same biggest region without moving it twice, and this one will be covered down is in a less time. So now you look here at the beams here. This one has got one single beam and this one has got two single pencil beams. So now tell me, which one do you think has got the highest radiation effect? Which one, the A or B? Man, if you guys are on a mobile net and if you are watching it on mobile, it is not my problem, right? Okay. So it will be seen down in B itself. Yes, you are correct. The radiation problem will be seen down in effect, in more in B. But still, what is beneficial for this one? Larger areas will be covered down within a short time itself. So like yesterday we were speaking, when low energy radiation has been exposed for a lower time, do you think that the radiation effects are negligible or not? That is what we learned about the cost beneficial effects of radiation yesterday. Yes or no? Right? When low energy radiation is falling down, doesn't matter whatever the time it is actually beneficial. So now here, the one of the biggest advantages of CT is that its benefits overweigh its effects, right? So even I know that there are hazards in a CT. Yes, CT has got much more bigger radiation effect, much more harmful than a conventional radiograph, but still CT's benefits overweighs its harmful effects. So that is the next difference between a CT and a conventional radiograph. And the third difference we can actually see is that a conventional radiograph will cover only a single anatomical region, but superimposing will be there. But this one, CT scan, will be doing down a particular anatomical region itself, but still acquiring you multiple planar images. So which one has got a better anatomical orientation, and you can observe the structures very, very easily, and the same kind of image clarity is also maintained. And so that's the reason, that is another benefit. And the same thing, you are trying to look down at all the anatomical planes of these images, a single X-ray beam that is being passed, same like in the conventional radiograph. So this one is much better and much more oriented for the anatomical structures. So this is the next difference between the CT and a conventional radiograph. as the technology advanced, what happened is that there is a fan beaming. You see here, the X-rays that are being released in C here are not parallel to each other, but they are tangentially moving on. So when they are tangentially moving on, what happens is that they will be taken down onto multiple detectors that are present down here. And it is covering the region that is covered by two X-ray beams here with the one beam itself, which is called as a fan beam. So now you tell me, which one is much better, B or C is better? Which one is much better? Two beams of pencil beams is okay, or one fan beam is okay, and when there is a rotation added to it. So which one is much better? C is much better. Now you see here, C, now which one has got less radiation effect? B or C, which one has got the less radiation effect when compared to others? C has got the less radiation effects. So it means to say, as the technology advanced, less radiation effect is taken down into consideration. While we observe the D also, you see here, this is trying to move down into 270 degrees or trying to move down into 360 degrees rotation with so many detectors here, then more fan beaming is coming down here. And when you actually see down the patient, you see here, this one will be covering a lot of slices. So which one is actually called as a cone beaming? Okay, this one actually here, this is like a fan, but later it becomes a cone. This one becomes a cone. It means to say it is covering down a dimensional area. So dimensional area means to say, let me show you here. Dimensional area in the sense, you see here, from here, this region to this region, when I completely put it here, okay, like this, see, when I put it from here to here, it will be actually the complete beam of the X-rays is like a cone, and it will be covering a larger part. And now at the same point of time, when the couch is simultaneously moving in, you can acquire the images very, very fast. So it means to say the complete anatomical orientation in different planes will be done within almost something like 2 to 3 times. For example, to say, if I'm taking something like 1 second to acquire a chest X-ray, I will be consuming something around like 5 to 10 seconds to acquire the complete thoracic region in all anatomical planes as desired. So this is one is much better. So better orientation of anatomical organs within less time. So that is one of the much more bigger benefits of a CT scan. Did you understand this? Was the concept clear? How the images are being acquired in a CT? So yes or no, please respond. PPT is not being shown, man. You have to check down on your network connection, man. Most of the people, I guess, are able to see it. If you are on mobile, I'm sorry, you please get onto the computer. Okay. Right. Okay. The next one. Now let us try to understand different generations of CTs. Okay. The first single pencil beam is a conventional radiograph. Conventional CT scan that is actually been invented, or the first thing that we worked before, which was actually invented by Sir Godfrey Hounsfield in 1969, and he got a Nobel Prize in 1972. So this is the one you see here. Well, the first image that was actually being acquired is onto the brain. So this one is actually, the gantry is actually moving horizontally itself. So this is Sir Godfrey Hounsfield. Then when you actually try to understand here, yesterday we were seeing that different tissues has got different densities, and different densities has got different tissue susceptibilities. And tissue susceptibilities as Leisha also is having radiation quality factor in them, right? So the radiation quality factor and the tissue susceptibility taken together will actually form different kinds of densities on a CT scan, which can also be measured as a unit called as a Hounsfield scale. Okay, so understand this term here. Hounsfield scale is a quantitative scale for describing radio density. Okay, it is a Hounsfield scale is a quantitative scale for describing radio density. Yesterday on the conventional radiograph, we have seen that Ront, Gen, Rad, Rem, Sievert, Gray, Coulombs, and other things are the units of radiation. So what is the unit of measure here is the Hounsfield scale. So depending on the RQF, radiation quality factor, and the tissue susceptibility, we will measure, and each tissue that is present will show different kinds of densities with different kinds of HU value. And that one, when I'm trying to look down the HU value, okay, I will explain that once more, but still first try to understand this. Whenever I try to measure, whenever I'm trying to look at A on the CT scan, yes, it will give me, if I try to measure the Hounsfield value there, it will be giving down me minus 1000 Hounsfield units. Okay, these values are very important to remember for examination purpose. So just try to understand here. So air, where the complete completely reflecting the X-rays, and the it is completely becoming black, the same way how the different tissues are shown down on the conventional radiograph itself, this is the same way how it is shown on a CT itself. So A shows minus 1000 Hounsfield units, fat shows minus 50 to minus 100, water shows 0, muscle shows 10 to 40, blood shows approximately 60, and contrast studies, okay, we will do this in a short while, it shows 130, and bone shows greater 400. And bones are the organs that appear again white on a CT scan, and air is the structure again, air is a medium that actually shows up as a black on a CT also, both the same way itself. Okay, so this is actually the measurement of the quantitative scale of the tissue susceptibility and radiation quality factor on a CT is nothing but your Hounsfield units that determines the color of your image. Is that clear? What is a Hounsfield unit? Is it clear? Yes or no? Right. Okay. The next one, we will not get into the details of this one, but still try to remember CTDI volume and DLP are the most common type of units that are being used in a CT, where like RAD, REM, GRAY, and Sieverts, what you used on a conventional radiograph, we will be using computer tomography dose index per volume of a anatomical region. For any given volume of any anatomical plane is called as a CTDI. So this is the specific unit for trying to find out how much of radiation effects are there, or how much of radiation that is being taken by the patient. Okay, this one is the absorbed dose unit in a computer tomography. Then there is another kind of unit that is called as the size-specific dose estimate. Size-specific dose estimate, the same thing like the absorbed dose, whose units are gray yesterday. Now here we will be seeing down in milligray, right? Then it is a method of estimation, CT radiation dose that takes patient in a patient size taken into account. So now you have to understand one peculiar thing here. Okay, thin people will take less radiation, fat people will take more radiation. Yes or no? Right? Size specific dose estimate will actually say that, okay, thin people has got less surface area, where the fat people face area. So larger surface area means to say larger exposure to the radiation, but it's still does not change the absorbed dose. Absorbed dose is always dependent on the type of the tissue, either it will absorb the radiation or reflect the radiation. So the last line here speaks about that one. The exposures are same regardless of the patient size. But the size of the patient is a factor in overall patient's absorbed dose. So absorbed dose is controlled. How much the patient is being taken, how much radiation that the patient is absorbing is directly dependent on to the size of the patient, but it does not change anything in the exposure, right? So exposure does not have any kind of relation to patient size, but the size of the patient has got a direct relation to the amount of radiation that is being absorbed. So that is what the takeaway point here is. So thin people will have less radiation, fat people will have more radiation, and at the same time, the advancement of the technology that we are using, either pencil beam, or either we are using two pencil beams, or either we are using fan beam, or either we are using cone beam, all these things will actually determine and change the computer tomography dose index. So logically speaking, we can understand from this that CT scans has got much more higher radiation risk when compared to the conventional X-ray, right? So that is what we were trying to learn about the dosage limits yesterday. So CT scan has got more absorbed dose, and they have got more radiation effects. Now, CBERT S also is another unit that is also being same like yesterday. Yes, they also will give you the biological risks of the entire anatomical organs, right? Now let us try to look at this, some generations of the CT, different types of CT images, or different types of CT scans that are available in the modern day technology. The first thing that we actually need to understand here is a very, very special technology that is called as spiral CT. Spiral CT are also called as helical CT. Helical CT and spiral CT is that it has got the rotation of the gantry, which is also correlating with the movement of the couch. Okay, couch in the sense the bed of the patient here. Okay, the rotation of the gantry is simultaneous to the planes of the rotation, the movement of the patient's bed or the couch. We call this as couch. So which means to say, circular motions of the gantry and the simultaneous forward movement of the patient will acquire images in a spiral-like manner. The images are acquired as a spiral-like manner, and there are so many detectors that are present down here, which means to say faster imaging acquisition will be done, and multiplanar imaging acquisition will be done, right? So the image that we actually seen here, here and here is a spiral CT, okay? This is a spiral CT. Which one has got a better orientation? Spiral CT has got a better orientation for the observation of the anatomical structures in so many planes, as well as they can also be used to reconstruct them as 3D images. So such kind of a technology is mostly favorable for observation of blood vessels and cardiovascular system. Okay, understand this one thing here. The spiral CT is used for mostly for the anatomical structures in multiple planes, and also whenever it is ready to construct them in a 3D way so that we can see them. So that we can try to observe the structures non-invasively and try to observe the anatomical regions or the pathologies as the real-time imaging itself. Okay, so this is called as a 3D reconstructed image here, where I have got the axial plane, I have got the coronal plane, and I have got the sagittal planes. So three planes when together, I am converting them down into my algorithm, and finally I can obtain a 3D reconstructed area, which actually looks like the endoscopic image, but still the logic is that I'm not using my endoscope here. So, which is a non-invasive virtual endoscopic CT. So, such kind of greater things can be achieved by spiral CT. And then we have got a better things. We have got a dual CT. Dual CT has got two X-ray tubes. One has got the high X-ray tube, high voltage X-ray tube, and the other one has got the low X-ray voltage tube. Then both of them will have different tissue densities, and both of them will have different tissue radiation quality factors. And then finally, what happens is that it is technically used down in angiography, or it is technically used down in functional imaging of CT, which means to say, whenever I'm trying to understand a pathology, the type of pathology, for example, to say, if I'm trying to observe an atherosclerotic patient, okay, atherosclerotic patient has got so many types of mixed plaques or the cholesterol plaques that are actually formed down in the arteries and arterioles, okay. So when I'm trying to observe the characteristic nature, either if it is a calcified plaque, or if it is a cholesterol plaque, or if it is a mixed plaque, or the same way, when a patient has got kidney stones in them, I'm trying to observe if the patient has got uric crystals, or if the patient has got calcium crystals, or if the patient has got cysteine crystals. So when I'm trying to observe the characteristic lesions, when I'm trying to learn about the characteristic lesions, this one will provide me, because yesterday we learned that when high energy is being passed, the tissues will respond some way. When low energy is passed, it will respond somehow, right? So there is a differences in the densities, yes or no? Is this clear? There is a difference between this or not? Yes or no? Please respond. Right? Okay. So there is high energy has got one kind of density image, and low energy has got one kind of density image. When the same anatomical region with certain kind of pathology are taken down with two different voltages of X-ray beams, will give you what kind of a lesionicity and what is the composition of it. So such kind of things is used in functional imaging, and technically speaking, we can use it in angiographic views or the blood vessels. And I'm trying to observe the blood vessels, the pathologies of the blood vessels. I'm trying to use a dual CT. Okay. Then we have got another technology that is called as multi-slice detector CT, or MDCT, we call it as. The only difference between spiral CT and multi-slice CT is that it has got so many detectors. The same detectors are technically either one detector, okay, two detectors, or we have got like a 64 slice CT, or we have got 128 slice CT, and we have got 256 slice CT. The same like the pixels what we see in a like a digital camera, the same thing like that is happening here in a multi-slice detector CT also. More the detectors, more clarity of the image without any kind of loss in resolution. So images are better resolution, images have a good contrast, they are shown down in better anatomical planes, they can be virtually reconstructed down into 3D structures. Yes, you can also observe the characteristics of the pathology. Yes, these are all the benefits of CT. So the benefits of the CT overweighs its radiation hazard. But it doesn't necessarily mean to say that, yes, I can use the CT as I wanted. Even the X-ray cannot be prescribed without a specific reason. The same way, unless you know what kind of a lesion you are looking at, unless you know what kind of a pathology you are expecting down in a patient in the provisional diagnosis, we do not prescribe a CT unless and until it is necessary. If you require the information in multiple planes only, if you require a more clear image of the pathological progression of the disease, yes, we prescribe a CT. If not, we are not going to prescribe a CT. So that is what the about the CT itself. Okay. Later on, learn about the advantages and disadvantages. The biggest disadvantages of the CT is that it has got a lot of radiation effects. And the same thing here, it does not show any kind of soft tissue detail. So soft tissue detail is not as good as MRI. So that's the reason CT is generally used for observing mostly lungs. And then we are also trying to observe at mostly skeletal structures, right? Okay. Now, we get into different densities, okay? We get into different densities. So this is the main chapter today that we need to... Okay, can everybody see these new slides? Can everybody see it? The five basic densities, yes or no? Right, no? Right, okay. The five basic densities. Now, yesterday we were talking about the radiation quality factor. Now, let us try to observe what exactly are these densities. How these densities look down on the radiograph. So in conventional radiography, it is limited to demonstrating five basic densities. And the five basic densities, the same thing what we also saw on CT before, it is air which appears blackest on a radiograph. Remember, air appears black. Then we have got fat, and fat has got water content in it. And they show up a lighter shade of gray than air. Okay, air is blackest. So which means to say fat will appear gray on a radiograph. Then we have got much more better things which has got a soft tissues and a fluid. Both soft tissues and fluid also will appear a little bit of white. Whiter gray and a little bit less than real white. Okay, so soft tissues appear much more brighter than fat, and that way I can recognize these structures. That is, I'm looking at a soft tissue or a fluid. Then we have calcium in the body. Technically speaking, calcium is stored down in the enamel and also it is stored down in the bones. So they are the bright ones. They are the ones that generally appear very much white. Okay. So, and then we have metals. Metals are the absolute structures that appears completely white on a radiograph. So this is the sequence which appears blackest. Air is the one that appears blackest and whitest. Metal is the one that appears whitest. So logically speaking, do we have any kind of a metals? Okay, metal in the sense, okay, do we have any heavy alloys in our body? Do we have any heavy alloys in our body? Yes or no? No, obviously no, right? So which means to say there are very, very few structures that appear completely, completely white. But now, okay, so the yes, we have some kind of alloys. We have got some kind of minerals. But their amount is completely negligible when compared to the structure, when compared to the real metal, what we see every day. Okay, their density or their amount is completely negligible when compared to the other ways. So which one appears bright in a radiograph? We can technically say bones are the ones that appear white, but in presence of a metal, logically speaking, whenever there is a prosthesis, okay, a foreign body that is present down, which is a metallic foreign body that is present down, it will appear much more whiter than even the bones itself. Okay, I will show you the example, then you can understand much better. Okay, first, let's try to understand here. You see here, air absorbs the least X-rays, which means to say air is the one that reflects most of the X-rays, and then there is no there is penetration, and finally they get onto the X-ray film and they burn the film and it causes blackness on the film. So that's the reason air appears black. Then fat, it is gray and somewhat darker or blacker than the soft tissue. Then soft tissues are the one that appears real grays and they have almost the same densities on a conventional radiograph. Then calcium, they are the most dense and they are the most white also in non-presence of a metal. And metal, when present, yes, they appear usually whitest on the radiograph. So this one, you do not forget about these density changes. Okay, this is very, very important. Okay, now let's try to look here. Now in this image, let me put down at a point and you tell me, just let us try to understand and just let us try to recognize the colors first. Then we will get into details. Okay, this one is showing up as gray or white. Okay, the mouse I pointed here, you see here, this one, the point I put here, is it showing up as gray or white? Gray. So which means to say, what I am the structure that I am looking at? Okay, what is this anatomical region that I am looking at? What is the anatomical region that I am looking at? Axilla. So what I am looking at? I am looking at the axillary folds. Did you understand here? So that is how I am using my anatomical knowledge to the colors that are present down on a radiograph, and I am trying to orient myself onto the 3D anatomy here from this 2D image. I'm going to extract such kind of information depending on the densities, depending on the colors that are present down here. Now let me point down to another structure and you tell me what is the structure that I'm looking at. Okay, you here, you tell me what is the structure that I'm looking at here. This line, white line I'm looking at. Okay, what is the structure that I'm looking at here? Clavicle. Technically speaking, you be more clear, we are looking at the superior border of the clavicle. Yes or no? Yes or no? Right, I'm looking at the superior border of the clavicle. And you see here, when let me try to zoom in. Okay, let me try to zoom in here. And when I zoom in, when I try to zoom in, okay, now you see here, this one, the structure that is passing up above the clavicle, this one is looking a little gray. So do you think that I am looking at the clavicle here or something that is above the clavicle? Is that any kind of a thing? Okay, you see, did you understand my question? I'm looking at the white line here. You said this is the clavicle, which technically speaking is the superior border of the clavicle. Now I'm looking at the gray area that is present down here, which is present above the clavicle. So what is the structure I am looking at? Soft tissue, right? Supraclavicular fold. Aman, there, what kind of muscle is present here? What is the muscle that insert down into the clavicle? Okay, right. So here is the muscle that is actually being inserted down into the clavicle, but here I am looking it down at the soft tissue, supraclavicular fold, skin fold I'm looking at. So whenever I came to understand, okay, whenever I'm looking at the density, I'm trying to look what kind of anatomical structure I'm looking at. And at the same way, here I am looking at air. You see here, this completely black that is appearing as air. And so lungs has got air in them, and lungs are the structures that are appearing completely, completely black. Then I have got heart. Heart is a soft tissue. It is a muscle. And it also has got blood in it. So, and it is a dense tissue. So that's the reason it is appearing some gray to white here. But when I'm looking much more carefully here, sorry, when I'm looking much more carefully here, you can see a black thing that is actually passing in center of the radiograph here. So this black thing I'm just looking at here is the trachea, and trachea has got air in it, so it is looking black. So I apply the logic of densities here, and I try to find the anatomical region, and then I'm looking at trachea. But do you think that this black region that is showing up here is not trachea? So we cannot make such kind of a mistake. So anatomical orientation is always necessary when we are trying to observe with the radiograph. Okay, right? You see, this structure that we are looking at is the aorta. Okay, we will deal this about this normal anatomy in more detail. Okay, we will deal with more detail, but still first try to understand these densities here. Okay, this structure that I am looking here is much more wider when compared to the other structures that are present. So I am looking at the vertebral bones. Okay, I'm looking at the lumbar vertebrae. Okay, these are the thoracic vertebrae and these are the lumbar vertebrae. And you see here, this one is much more dense tissue that is present down here, and it is looking some gray to white here. I'm looking at the domes of the diaphragm. So you see here, air that is present down within the lungs, and it is appearing black. And I am looking at the fat tissues and other things, dense structures, myocardial muscle. And sorry, this is the fat I am looking at here, subcutaneous tissue. It is appearing a little bit grayer. And then I am looking at the soft organ. It is a vestigial tissue. It has got no function in the stability of the joint. It just only prevents hyperextension, and also patella is present down within the tendon or the ligament of the quadriceps femoris muscle. Right? Yes or no? Did you learn this before? Patella has got no role in the stability of the joint. The stability of the joint will be maintained by the cruciate ligaments. So that is not patella. Patella is not replaced. Patella is still present down here. What is being replaced? The distal end of the femur is being replaced, and again the proximal end of the tibia and fibula, which means to say the meniscus that are present down along the synovial joint of the popliteal region is being replaced. So which means to say knee is being replaced. So this one is a metallic prosthesis that has been attached to the meniscus, because in conditions like osteoporosis, what happens is that the complete destruction, there will be complete destruction of the surfaces of the joints, okay, articular surfaces of the joints, and then that will be replaced. So which is a metallic prosthesis, okay. So that's the reason we will be, these are generally made of titanium. So titanium is a heavy metal, and I am looking at the titanium meniscus that has been replaced the knee. That's it. Okay. So whenever there is a metal that is present, yes, it appears much more whiter than the bones. But if no metal is present, yes, bones are the ones that appear much more whiter. And you see here, I am looking at the pelvic region. I am trying to look at both the hip bones. Okay. Can now tell me here, I am looking at a very, very wide density here. Now you tell me, try to make a guess what kind of surgery that might have happened here. What is the surgery that might have happened here? Look at the area. There is a white density that is present over the left acetabulum. Left acetabulum or the left hip joint. There is a white density that is present down here. Now take a guess and what could have happened here. What is this surgery that has happened here? Any idea? Femoral fracture? Technically speaking, yes, it is femoral fracture. It is the replacement of the head of the femur. Yes, that is the correct answer. Replacement of the head. Hip joint replacement surgery. Yes. And you see here, there is a prosthetic head and the complete replacement of the acetabulum is done. I can see the cup shape of the acetabulum here, and I can see the ball shape of the femoral head here, and the complete. So it could have happened because of the femoral head along with neck fracture, you see, even the neck is being replaced and completely it is bored down into the shaft of the femur. So complete hip replacement surgery that is actually happening here. So that is one of the things. And but these are very simple here. I'm not teaching you any pathology. I'm just trying to teach you how to recognize the lesions. Okay. Now, let us get into more depth of these lesions. Let me share a new slide. Do you guys want a break now for 10 minutes? Yes, it is 1 hour almost. Yes, no. Okay, let us have a break of 10 minutes. Okay, don't worry. Just go relax and come over. Okay, just break of 10 minutes. Take on. I will call you once again. First, I will cut the call. Right? Okay. There is no movement that is being captured on that 2D image. But fluoroscopy is one of the investigative modality that also utilizes x-rays, but it is used in performing a real-time visualization. Real-time visualization in the sense, where are the organs, for whichever organ that has got a dynamic function. Dynamic function in the sense, whichever the organ that moves, we will try to visualize. Now you try to tell me, what are the organs that are frequently moving down in your body? What are the structures that actually move down in your body? Any guess? What are the structures that frequently move? Heart, lungs, okay. Then stomach. So let us typically see here one thing. You need to understand, yes, they can be applied. Fluoroscopy can be technically applied to all the organs that move. But logically speaking here, lungs has got more air in it. Yes or no? Lungs has got more air in it, and air appears black on an x-ray. But we are trying to visualize the differences between blackness and whiteness. So specifically speaking, we cannot look air, and when the image is completely black, we are not going to interpret anything here, right? So what we actually do here, what we try to understand here, that there is a loss of contrast, or there is a presence of contrast, or there is a loss of tissue density that is present when there is air that is present down inside the organs. Yes or no? There is, see, any kind of a tissue has got some kind of a density. Air is got no density in it, so that is the reason it is appearing black on an x-ray. So when we are trying to observe the structures that has got air in it, and when I'm trying to observe their functional, in the real-time imaging, when I'm trying to observe their movement, the only thing what I'm trying to see here, I am to understand here, there is a one concept that is actually called as a natural contrast and an artificial contrast. Okay, let me get down to that one. We will learn the details of that thing. Okay, I'll show you. So can everybody see the new slides? Okay, in special techniques of radiography. So now you see here, any kind of a density, okay, there exists a density difference between human tissues. Okay, let us say the heart looks some way, the bones look some way, the air looks some way, the fat looks some way, the fluid looks some way. So such kind of a density that is actually present inside any kind of a human tissue, and they produce some kind of a image, are with different kind of white density or different because of blackness. So such kind of a contrast is actually called as a natural contrast. So that is actually happening because either the tissues are either observing the x-rays, or they are completely reflecting the x-rays. So such kind of a contrast is called as a natural contrast. But there are some kind of issues which do not have this kind of natural contrast. For example, to say, if I'm trying to look at down the intestines, if I'm trying, more specifically speaking, I'm trying to look at down the intestines. So they do not have any kind of a contrast. And if I still wanted to look at such kind of organs, I will try to use a material that is being introduced into them, which is actually called as a contrast material, okay? The material that is used to give the contrast to the structures that cannot be clearly visualized. Blood vessels, example, blood vessels. Blood vessels cannot be visualized on a conventional radiograph. And if I'm trying to observe the conventional radiograph, what I do is that I try to give a material, contrast material into them, and try to visualize the blood vessels. And at the same way, intestines have got more air in them. And also, when I'm trying to observe the intestines, I will give a contrast medium into the intestines, and I'm trying to observe their movement, and which actually shows up as brightness on an X-ray. They actually look up more white, which is almost equal to the metal. And such kind of contrast is called as artificial contrast. So the contrast that has been achieved, to the structure which cannot be visualized by a natural contrast, by administration of an contrast material, is called as artificial contrast. So for the visualization of such kind of structures, and when I'm trying to observe them in real time, so what is the thing I'm using? What is the technique that I'm using? I'm using a technique called as fluoroscopy, right? So fluoroscopy is the capability of real-time organ imaging, creating a movement of picture, which is organ dynamic function. When I'm trying to assess the functional capacity of such kind of a organ, especially intestines, within a patient, and I'm trying to observe the patient while moving the patient into different anatomical planes. So I can actually understand how these organs are moving and how these organs are functioning. So functional imaging for the movement, based on the movement of the organs, is called as fluoroscopy. But logically speaking, yes, this is also a 2D image itself. It is also a 3D anatomical region superimposed on a 2D image itself, but I'm looking down it as a video, but I'm not looking it as a single image that has been taken down on a conventional radiograph. So that is the only biggest difference between a fluoroscopy and a conventional radiograph. So what are the advantages? So such kind of things actually gives more advantage to the fluoroscopy. So they are simple, they are immediate, they are multi-axial because I am viewing them in a lot of planes, and they are polypositional. And at the same point of time, I am studying their organic functional state. Did you understand this, or do you want me to explain once again? The thing is that the difference between a conventional radiograph and a fluoroscopy is that I am trying to observe them in real time, and I am trying to observe the functional capacity and the organ capacity of the trying to observe the functional capacity and the organ capacity of the organs that has no natural contrast in them by introducing a contrast material into them. And I will be able to do them in poly position, in multiple positions. And by that way, I'm studying their organic and functional state. So best example for such kind of, imaging things is actually barium contrast study. Remember the name, barium contrast study of the intestine. So the image that I'm looking down here is the barium contrast study of the large intestine. So I'm looking at the valvular conventus, and I'm looking at the ostrations of the intestine here, and I'm looking at the complete anatomical orientation of the intestine. So by some way or the other, I'm trying to diagnose the disease. We will learn them in more detail, yes, but don't worry. But just try to understand, I have introduced a contrast material called as barium sulfate into the large intestine so that I can visualize the complete anatomical orientation of the large intestine. So since the large intestine does not have any kind of a contrast that is present down to it, so I have given an artificial contrast so that the barium can line over the mucosa of the intestine so that it can be visualized clearly. So that is what in fluoroscopy is done. And here, the images are taken simultaneously over time. And the best examples are the things that are seen here. See, I'm trying to use the contrast studies. I'm trying to use the... I'll tell you. I'm coming over. So there are different types of contrast studies that are related to the intestines. So such kind of contrast studies, the main important contrast material that we actually use here is barium sulfate. Okay, remember barium sulfate, BASO4. BASO4 is a contrast material that appears as a powder. We mix them with water and then it will be administered through mouth. So per oral administration will be taken. And then when I am taking pictures at different time intervals, for example, to say when I'm trying to observe the esophagus, and esophagus has got peristaltic movement in them, and while I'm having the peristaltic movement, I ask the patient first to drink and hold the barium into his mouth. Once he has them in mouth, I prepare the machine and I ask the patient to swallow it. And if it is swallowing it, the patient, actually the barium goes down into the oropharynx, and from the oropharynx it mounts down into the upper part of the esophagus, then it goes down to the peristaltic from the first constriction of the esophagus, then it moves down into the middle part of the esophagus, then finally it is going down into the lower part of the esophagus and finally entering down into the stomach. So now I can understand if there is any kind of a problem that is present down within the esophagus. Now let us try to orient this within the clinical study. Now let us see if a 48-year-old male has been complaining of dysphagia. Okay, a 48-year-old male has been complaining with dysphagia for the last 1 month. Now, the doctor, what is the disease that he might be suspecting about? Okay, what are the most common causes of dysphagia? Dysphagia is nothing but painful swallowing. Okay, can anybody take a guess and tell me what are the most common causes of dysphagia? Painful swallowing. If your diagnostic class has started, then yes, you must be able to answer this question. Okay, dysphagia. Painful swallowing. Tonsillitis. Okay, logically speaking, tonsillitis, but your tonsils are present within your oropharynx. Oropharynx is technically not a part of gastrointestinal tract. The gastrointestinal tract actually starts from esophagus, yes or no? Right? So yes, you are some way or the other. Yes, if I want to observe tonsillitis also, yes, I can make a barium study, but logically speaking, I'm talking about esophagus problems here, and GI tract actually starts from esophagus. Yes, inflammation of the esophagus, right? Swellings of the esophagus. Okay, what is that term? Swelling of the esophagus? I never heard there is a swelling of the esophagus. Okay, you might say either it has a stricture. Okay, there is no swellings in the esophagus. We can either call them as diverticula, fistulas, or strictures of the esophagus. Okay. Right. And yes, esophagitis. Yes, esophagitis is one of the conditions. Barrett's esophagus. Yes, Barrett's esophagus is the, you know, a dysplastic change that is happening of the esophagus, where the squamous epithelium is converted down into the columnar epithelium. And columnar epithelium, intestinal columnar epithelium changes is happening down in the esophagus. So if I'm trying to observe such kind of a change, actually, I'm trying to do that, how the swallowing movements are going on and how the barium is getting settled down onto this mucosa. So that is exactly how this barium study is trying to analyze me. And the next thing, I can see whenever the thing that has been entered down into the stomach, yes, the stomach has also got six peristaltic movements, and it is moving down from the gastric antrum, and then it is going down into the pylorus, and then finally going down, getting from antrum to the greater curvature, and greater curvature to lesser curvature, and lesser curvature to the pylorus. So I am trying to understand these peristaltic movements, and I am trying to observe here. So could you tell me what exactly some kind of the problems that might be assessed in the stomach? What are some of the diseases that you know in the stomach? What are some of the diseases of the stomach? Let us say, what are the diseases that you know of stomach? Gastritis, yes, ulcers, then what else? Gastritis, ulcers, then what else do we have? Gastric carcinoma, right? Gastric carcinoma, stomach cancers. See, all these three things, yes, you are, all the three are the most important indications: gastritis, peptic ulcer diseases, and gastric cancers, and gastric outlet obstructions. Gastric outlet obstruction, which is also known as pyloric stenosis. Yes, worms in stomach. What kind of worms? Can you tell me what is the name of the worm in a stomach? Any idea? Ascariasis. Yes, technically speaking, yes, ascariasis do not happen inside the stomach. It actually happens inside the intestines. Roundworms, ringworms, yes. But most of the common conditions that will be actually coming down within is, you know, gastritis, gastric ulcers, peptic ulcer diseases, and gastric carcinoma, and gastric outlet obstruction. Yes, gastroparesis is also one of the condition where there is a complete dysmotility of the gastric gastric mucosa, right? So I'm trying to understand, analyze such kind of a condition by lining of the barium along the mucosa. So now let us say, if the barium is not seen in some kind of area, or if the barium is being accumulated in some kind of area, I try to understand if it is being accumulated, or if it is completely thrown away, or if it is completely washed off, or it is completely being filled up. So such kind of things I am observing in real time. So at the real time itself, I am trying to understand where exactly the problem is present here. If there is any disruption in the gastric mucosal folds, or if there is any erosion of the gastric mucosal folds, or is there any elevation of the gastric mucosal folds, okay? Depression in the gastric esophageal folds will actually try to accumulate barium in them, and it will indicate me that I'm looking at an ulcer. And if there is an elevation in the gastric mucosa, the fluid cannot settle down on elevation, it flows down. So I'm looking at a black area, and I'm looking at a gastric cancer. Okay, you will learn that in GI system, but try to understand that barium studies are the one that are used for GI tract investigations. You see here, these are the better things. There are four types of barium studies. Okay, there are, the first one is actually called as a barium swallow. Okay, the first one is actually called as a barium swallow. I ask the patient to take barium and then swallow it. When he is swallowing it, I am trying to observe his esophagus, and such kind of investigation done for the observation of esophagus before it reaches the stomach is called as barium swallow. And then barium meal in the sense meal goes down into the stomach. So what is the thing that I am trying to observe from the barium meal is that I am trying to observe the gastric antrum, and I am trying to also observe the jejunum and the ileum, barium meal. Then I have got the barium enema. Barium enema in the sense I am not actually giving down the barium from the mouth, because it takes a lot of time, because the patient has to undergo something around like 3 to 6 hours of digestion. So that's the reason if I'm trying to observe intestines of the lower intestines, okay, for example, to say larger intestine, like I'm trying to observe the sigmoid colon, or if I'm trying to analyze the rectum, it takes a long time for me to pass, and I have to let the patient wait for 6 hours. So what I generally do is that I administer the patient barium through rectum itself. So I am giving it as enema. So if I'm trying to observe the lower gastrointestinal tracts, the investigation done here is called as a barium enema. And if it is done for the upper gastrointestinal tracts, I am doing it as a barium swallow and a barium meal. And finally, when it comes down to the intestine, yes, it is called as barium meal. And when it is flowing down through the intestines, such kind of investigation is actually called as a barium follow through. Okay, barium follow through. Now on the right side, we can see a lot of images here, right? This is the barium enema, that is investigation that is being done. Here, this is the barium follow through. Here, barium follow through. And here I have given a barium meal. Okay, barium meal, jejunum and ileum. This one is a barium meal, barium follow through. And this one is also barium follow through. And then I'm looking here is the barium enema. I can say this is a barium enema just the reason because I can see a lot of barium accumulation down within the rectum and the sigmoid colons itself. So which means to say the route of administration of barium in barium enema is not through mouth. It is actually through anal canal. So did your question get cleared now? Before somebody was asking, what is the route of administration? Yes, for observation of gastrointestinal tract, upper gastrointestinal tract, what is the investigation I do? I do a barium swallow and I do a barium meal. But if I'm trying to understand, if I'm trying to analyze the lower gastrointestinal tract, I'm giving an enema through anal canal. And such thing is actually called as a barium enema. So the route of administration is through anal canal. So that is the different things. So that's kind of moving backward is technically called as retrograde administration. Okay, retrograde administration. And there is, you see here, there are a lot of studies here. I'll show you. You see here, I was talking, this is what I was talking about before in this image. Here you can see here, I can see in the gastric antrum here, there is a complete filling of the barium in the lower parts of the stomach. But in the upper parts of the stomach, you see here, there is a small black area. Generally, where in this area, barium has to be filled up, it did not fill up. So before I was taking where the barium do not fill up, if there is an elevation inside the gastric mucosa, so what am I looking at here? I'm looking at a gastric cancer. Did you understand? The thing is that, okay, if there is a filling defect, the barium accumulation will not be happening and I look at a black area, which suggests to me that I am looking at a gastric cancer, which is technically called as a filling defect on a barium study. And you see here, these are the much more, and I'm trying to locate the patient. I'm moving down in different positions. Okay, I'm trying to move down in different positions. And I'm trying to observe the anatomy of the intestine in different views. I'm trying to look down it from lateral view. I'm trying to look down in the oblique view. Such kind of dynamic imaging is possible while the barium is completely flowing through. By this, I can understand his gastric absorptional capacity. By this, I can also understand what is the movement of the peristalsis, movement of the intestines. I am knowing about his peristaltic state. And I am also knowing about his absorptional state. And I'm also knowing about his, I'll tell you, wait. And we are also trying to look at different things. And you see here in this image, we can see here, there is a barium that has been ingested from the mouth and finally it went down into the stomach. And you see here, there is no further filling of the barium in the intestine. Even after waiting for 6 hours also, there is no further filling of the intestines. You see here, this kind of a condition will actually happening because of a gastric outlet obstruction. Gastric outlet obstruction, technically the term is called as a pyloric stenosis. So there is no barium fill in the lower intestines, and which is actually happening because of the proximal obstruction to the gastric outlet, which suggested me, without the filling of the perium in the lower parts of the intestines, has suggested me the diagnosis of pyloric stenosis. And now you see here, this one condition, here there are a lot of heterogeneous areas that are present down here. Heterogeneous in the sense, a disturbed view of the esophagus that is present down here. And you see here, there is small, small accumulation of barium, and some parts did not even accumulate of barium. And it is actually happening because of the quick washout of the barium in the esophageal tube. How much barium that is being given, some areas it is being accumulated, and most of the areas are being washed out because of the force. And that is actually happening because of esophageal varices. Esophageal varices is a clinical condition where there will be a lot of bleeding from the esophagus because of the disruption of the esophageal arteries. Okay, small arteries of the esophagus are being disrupted and they will be bleeding. So a patient presenting up with the hematemesis means to say vomiting up of blood, okay, will be presented. And when I do a barium study, I can see a structure, I can see and densities like this. There is a complete washout of the barium and there is a little bit filling over the mucosa of the barium inside. Generally, after I take the barium inside the esophagus, it is completely moved down into the stomach. Nothing barium stays inside the esophagus no more. It directly enters down into the stomach after 3 seconds. But logically speaking, but I can still see here barium that is being accumulated here, and some areas are being completely washed out. So which means to say I am looking at a clinical condition called as esophageal varices. Did you understand what exactly, how the doctor was able to make the diagnosis of esophageal varices and pyloric stenosis? Or do you want me to explain more? Clear? Not clear. Okay, wait, I will tell you. Wait, I'm just coming once again. See, first I have taken barium inside, then finally it has reached down into the stomach. Man, please stop sharing your screen. I was unable to share my screen. So many people are sharing their screen. Please don't disturb my screen sharing. All right. Okay. Right. So barium has been taken. Even after waiting for 6 hours, there is no filling up of barium inside the intestines. By this, I was able to understand this is pyloric stenosis because there is a severe obstruction of the gastric outlet. So I got a diagnosis called as pyloric stenosis. Esophageal varices on the other side, when I take barium in through the esophagus, all the barium inside the esophagus moves inside the stomach within 3 seconds. Yes, none of your food stays down within the esophagus. Every food that you take has to finally reach down into the stomach for digestion, right? But it is staying down in the esophagus here itself. And then slowly after some time, here, then you see here, there is a lot of barium that is being accumulated in the first view. Then after some time, what happened is that there is some areas that are being present here, but most of the places that are being washed out. It means to say there is active secretions that are actually going on in the esophagus, which generally is happening because of the blood flow. The disrupted arteries in the esophagus are actually washing out or flushing out the barium that is being accumulated. So that is how I came to understand over time that I'm looking at a case of esophageal varices. On the other side here, there is two views that are called as emphase view and a profile view. Okay, emphase view and a profile view. These are two views that I am looking at different planes in the stomach. Okay, emphase view, I am looking at the lesser curvature of the stomach, and in the profile view, I am looking at the greater curvatures of the stomach. Okay, and facet view and profile view, we will get into more detail in gastrointestinal system. But you just understand here, I'm trying to look the stomach from above, and I'm trying to look at the stomach from the left side or the right side. And facet view, I'm looking at the complete face of the stomach. Profile view, I'm looking at from the overall, up above from the stomach. So that is emphase view and profile view. It is generally done to observe the peptic ulcer diseases. Okay. Emphase view and a profile view are the separate different positional x-rays taken down to observe the stomach from different angles. Okay. That is emphase view and profile view. We will deal with this when we are doing within the gastrointestinal system. There is another one, one of the most and frequently used investigation in fluoroscopy, which is actually called as renal fluoroscopy. Before, when I was trying to ask you what are the structures that have got an organic functional state, you said heart. Heart does not have any functional state. Heart is the only structure that actually pumps the blood. The function of the heart is only to collect blood and pump the blood. The functional capacity is actually happening in the blood vessels, where there is a lot of diffusion that is going on. There is a lot of perfusion and oxygenation to the tissues is happening. So that's the reason I was saying fluoroscopy and contrast materials are the one that are used for observation of blood vessels as well, right? But for heart and lungs, no, I am not trying to use the fluoroscopy, because heart does not have any functional capacity. Heart's function is to try to get the blood, take the blood, and then pump the blood. Heart does not store the blood, right? But there are some other structures, there are other organs which have got much more functional capacity. The best functional capacity is the kidneys. Glomerular filtration rate, any kind of water or any kind of nutrients or any kind of medicine that is being, drug that is being given down into the bloodstream will finally excrete some way or the other, right? Finally, it means to say they have to reach down the kidneys. So there is another kind of a fluoroscopy that is called as a renal fluoroscopy. If I'm trying to understand the functional capacity of the kidneys, right? That one I am trying to do an investigation called as cystourethrography. Cystourethrography, in the sense I'm trying to look at the ureters, I'm trying to look at the kidneys, I'm trying to look at the cyst. Cyst is nothing but bladder. Bladder here is urinary bladder. If I'm trying to look at all these structures, such kind of fluoroscopic test is actually called as an IVP. It is called as IVP. Okay, just wait, let me find the slide for you. Okay, here, you see here, different types of contrast studies. What I do is if I'm trying to look at the arteries or the blood vessels in common, I'm trying to do is called as CT angiography, which is also a fluoroscopic technique also, but it is actually utilized through CT. Then I have, if I'm trying to observe at the urethra, if I'm trying to look at the bladder, such kind of fluoroscopic technique is called as voiding cyst urethrography. See, don't understand the complete, you need not completely understand the procedures right now. The questions that will be asked is that, okay, what is the investigation that is done for kidney functional capacity? Trying to know about the kidney's functional capacity. What is the radiological investigation that is done? Okay, what is the radiological investigation done to analyze the bladder and the urethra? Something like that. Okay, you will be having the questions just like this. So then we have another condition called as intravenous pyelography. Intravenous pyelography, I am trying to observe the functional capacity of the kidney by the nephrons and the excretional capacity. So such kind of investigation technique is called as intravenous pyelography. So the route of administration of contrast material in an intravenous pyelography is IV route. Okay, it is not oral route, it is IV route. Barium studies are done through oral route administration. IV route is done for pyrography. Then I also have, if I'm trying to observe the fertility capacity, or if I'm trying to observe the problems that is present inside the uterus, I'm trying to do a special investigation that is called as hysterosalpingogram. Okay, the fluoroscopic investigative technique that is used for visualization of uterus and the fallopian tubules is called as hysterosalpingogram, where I am trying to insert, where I am trying to administer the contrast material through the vaginal opening, vaginal orifice, then finally getting into the cervix, and from cervix I am going down into the endometrium, uterine cavity, and from the uterine cavity I am lining over the endometrial mucosa, and finally I am moving down into the fallopian tubules, and finally I am reaching the isthmus and isthmus to ampulla. So I am going retrogradely like this. So such kind of technique is called as hysterosalpingogram. Did you understand this? Yes or no? There are four types of investigations on fluoroscopy: angiography, or if I am doing it on CT, I call it as CT angiography. If I'm trying to observe for veins, I'm call it as venography. Then if I'm trying to observe the urinary bladder and the urethra, I call it as voiding cyst urethrogram. Then if I'm trying to observe the fallopian tubules and the uterus, I am calling it as hysterosalpingography. If I'm trying to observe the nephrons or the functional capacity of the kidneys, I will be doing an IVP, which is called as intravenous pyrography. And if I'm also trying to look at the functional capacity of the pancreas and the gallbladder, which are assisting in the process of digestion, I will do it by the administration of endoscope. Okay, I will take the endoscope and I'm finally going down to the common bile duct regions. I'm finally moving down, finally coming down into the common bile duct, and then I'm trying to give the administration of the contrast material, which will visualize me the complete hepatobiliary ducts and also the pancreatic duct, which finally shows me the gallbladder and the common bile duct and the hepatic duct. The complete biliary tree visualization is done, okay, through the endoscope here. You see here, if I'm doing it through the endoscope, I call it as endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography. If I'm administering the contrast material under the guidance of an endoscope, it is called as endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography. So endoscopic cholangiopancreatography is an investigation of fluoroscopic modality, right? That is what you have to understand. I can also do the same thing from MR, which is called as MRCP, right? And here you see here, I can administer, if it into the veins, I can administer the functional capacity of the coronary arteries. So this is a coronary angiography that is being done here. Okay, right descending, anterior descending artery, right circumflex, left circumflex. Okay, if I'm trying to visualize all the blood vessels of the coronary arteries here, all the blood vessels of the heart, I'm trying to do it under the guidance of ECG. So I'm calling it as ECG guided angiography. Simple. Okay, so most of the things will actually see, I'm doing here angiography here, and this is actually ECG guided CT angiography. I'm trying to look down in the slices of the images, but I'm here, I'm looking at something same like x-rays here. This is angiography, and this is, you see here, this is CT angiography. So better information will be given here. Okay, so that is what your fluoroscopic study is all about. Right now, the last important topic for this you need to understand here. Now, contrast materials are the one that are the, there are different types of contrast materials. Any kind of a contrast material, any kind of a contrast material that is given down to enhance the visualization of the structures which does not have a natural contrast is called as a contrast material. Any kind of a material that is administered down to visualize the structure which does not have a contrast is called as a contrast material. There are different types of contrast material. You have to remember the names. Okay, that's it. You have to just remember the names. The contrast material that is used in gastrointestinal tract is barium sulfate, BASO4, which is actually given per oral. Then we have iodinated compounds, iodinated contrast materials like diatrazole, iopomidol, and which they are given as IV. Then there is a mixture of air and barium that is given together. Air is also ingested. Barium is also ingested either through mouth or rectum, which will actually give me a condition called as a double contrast study. So in what is the investigation that utilizes air and barium? Air and barium, so it is called as a double contrast study. Then I am only giving air, I call it as air arthrogram. And I am such things where generally we can actually see. Then there is another investigation that is called I give contrast material through lumbar puncture, and I'm trying to visualize the brain structure, so which is actually called as cerebrospinal pneumonia. Cerebrospinal pneumoencephalography. So that route of administration here is through lumbar puncture. Then if I administer carbon dioxide, yes, and then which gives a negative contrast agent, okay, for angiography. Then the contrast material that is used down in CT is iodinated compounds. This contrast material that is used down in gastrointestinal tract is barium sulfate and double contrast. And if I am doing for brain, I am doing it through contrast material. I am giving iodinated compound itself. It is called as a cerebrospinal pneumoencephalography. And then the contrast material that is used down in MR scanning. Remember, you have to remember this name. Okay. You have to remember this name. The contrast material that is given down in an MR investigation is called as a gadolinium contrast material. Okay, gadolinium contrast material. That's it. Okay, that's it. Remember the important questions here. You have to know the differences between conventional radiography and fluoroscopy. Then the advantages of fluoroscopy and different types of fluoroscopic investigations like barium studies, barium swallow, barium follow through, barium enema, and barium meal. Then I'm also trying to know about different types of contrast materials. For oral, IV contrast materials or enematic contrast materials are given through lumbar puncture. These are the things that you have to learn here. These are one more important. Okay. You can read later on. These are the examples here. Okay. This is not technically very much necessary. Right. Now, the last one we are going to look here is the for today's topic, we are going to look down is the some of the basic terms that we need to understand are the views or the anatomical orientations. The views or the anatomical orientations, right? Magnetic resonance imaging, okay. Right, then I will cover magnetic resonance imaging in 5 minutes, okay? Because you see, magnetic resonance imaging is very difficult to understand. Okay, but I will teach you. Okay, then wait, I will teach you. Okay. Right. Okay. Now, before we get into magnetic resonance imaging, yesterday I was telling there are two types of radiations, right? There is ionizing radiation and non-ionizing radiation. Ionizing radiations actually utilizes high energy electromagnetic radiation, where the other studies like magnetic resonance imaging are the one are the based on resonance capacities, right? Or so MR is an investigation which actually uses magnets and the magnetic fields or the magnetic waves resonate together and finally try to produce some images. So such kind of thing is actually called as magnetic resonance imaging. Now, the logic behind actually, it is a non-ionizing radiation. So the question that might be asked for you is, okay, what is the investigation that does not utilize any kind of radiation? Okay, what is the investigation that does not use any kind of radiation? The answer will be MRI. Okay, MRI does not use any kind of radiation. Get it? So the question here will be, what is the investigation that does not use any kind of radiation? And can you take a guess and tell me from yesterday's class, what other investigation modality that is available which also does not give any radiation? What is the investigation that does not have any kind of radiation? USG, ultrasonography. Ultrasonography is also one that is using sound waves, right, and trying to produce an image. So magnetic resonance imaging and ultrasound are the ones that does not have any kind of investigation. Now, we also came to understand that ionizing radiation has got some kind of harmful effects on the body. Yes or no? And that harmful effects can be actually I told you yesterday that these harmful effects are present high in actively dividing cells. So which means to say, most of these ionizing radiations cannot be prescribed for a pregnant woman or a person who is a child, where the oogenesis and spermatogenesis is actively going on, active development is going on in them. So I cannot prescribe an ionizing radiation for a person who has actively dividing cells. For best example for that is pregnancy, because pregnancy, there is embryo. Embryo is the actively dividing cells, and there is a teratogenic effect that might be happening, because it might actually cause us fetal death, or the fetal genetic mutations can happen. So what is the investigation of choice that might be done during pregnancy? Options, let us say CT scan, X-ray, MRI, and ultrasound. Okay, what can you do? What is the best investigation of a choice that is prescribed in a pregnant woman? Okay, why is it not MRI? Okay, we will learn while we learn about the technique of MRI much more. Okay, first, you try to understand, before learning about MRI, you have to understand few little things. Yesterday I was talking about that the densities that are present down the tissues, how the tissues respond to different ionizing radiation. But this complete basis of MRI is entirely different from this one. Okay, now first you understand here, there are two important scientists who has introduced MRI in the application of medicine. It is Paul Lauterbach and Mansfield, got Nobel Prize. It is a fairly, you know, a very, very, you know, new investigation which has been introduced to medicine very, very recently, something around like 20 years ago. But the investigations, the research has been going on for the last 40 years. But finally, in 2003, Lauterbach and Mansfield got Nobel Prize for introduction of MRI into the use of medicine. Now, the whole MRI principle is based on one single thing. It is actually happening based on the water, presence of water. In the basic physiology, we know that 70% of the human body is made up of water, right? And water has got two hydrogen atoms in them, right? Two hydrogens and one oxygen. And finally, when I'm trying to break down, when I'm trying to put those hydrogen atoms within a magnetic field, they either gain the energy or they actually lose the energy. Okay. When I try to put a hydrogen atom within a magnetic field, it will either try to gain the energy or lose the energy. And finally, when I'm at the same point of time, if I'm giving some radio frequency to it, okay, at the same time, when I'm trying to give some kind of a radio frequency to it, either these cells arrange in normal way or some kind of an abnormal way. Okay, and that one is actually detected. That one is actually detected by a image. Detected by a detector, and then finally the image is formed. So the main ion that is responsible for formation of magnetic resonance imaging is hydrogen protons. Okay, hydrogen protons. First, simple, try to understand this one. The ions that are responsible for magnetic resonance imaging is hydrogen proton. What actually happens here, when hydrogen protons are placed within a magnetic field, they either align, they either lose energy, or either they gain energy, and finally they cause such kind of images which will be detected, right? Now first try to understand the structure of structure of a MRI machine. You see here, the difference between a structure of an MRI machine and a CT machine is that you see here, there, this is the gantry, where the gantry has got a high power magnet. See here, we have got a high power magnet, and there are coils around them, which is made up of copper, okay, which is actually called as a radio frequency coil, okay. There are two structures. The main structures that are present within the gantry is a high power magnet, and along with a radio frequency coil. Now, what happens whenever I put a copper wire within a magnet? Simple basic physics. I'm going to create some kind of electromagnetic radiation. Yes or no? Faraday's law, as simple as that. Right? Whenever I try to put a copper coil within a high powered magnet, I am going to create what? I am going to create some kind of electromagnetic radiation, and that is the one that is actually being imposed onto the patient, right? So then also you see here, but there is a lot of interference whenever there is, you see, I cannot just put the magnet and copper that is present down. There is a lot of electromagnetic radiation that is coming all around, and that radiation is also completely scattered if I'm not saving this energy, right? That is what the Faraday's law talks about, that the electrical currents and the magnets are in perpendicular direction, and the energy that is released is in the diagonal position, right? XYZ, Faraday's law, right? Three finger rule, right? If you can remember that, there is a loss of energy. So what I do is that I have got a big box, or there I have got a big area which actually prevents the electromagnetic radiation from loss. Okay, so the difference between a CT, the CT has got only one single gantry, but an MRI machine has got a big cage. Okay, MRI has got a big cage, right? Then, and the other thing is that this one actually looks like a tunnel inside. It looks like a tunnel, okay, something like a tube. Okay, I think I have the image there. MRI machine looks like a tunnel. Okay, just understand that it looks like a tunnel. So inside, whenever I try to give one thing, now you try to understand here, listen very carefully. I have hydrogen atoms in my body. All the cells and all the fluid, there is a lot of hydrogen atoms that are randomly arranged. See here, these are the cells or the hydrogen protons that are randomly arranged. Okay, then I put them under a magnetic field. I put them under a strong magnetic field. When I put them under a strong magnetic field, depending upon their energy loss or energy gain, they either arrange themselves down to the poles, either down to the north pole or either down to the south pole. Okay, depending on their properties, some hydrogen protons will align them properly. But where they are randomly present here, now they became completely ordered, right? They became so much ordered. They became arranged in a sequential manner. Then, at the same point of time, what I'm trying to do is that I am trying to give a radio frequency impulse. At the same point of time, first I have randomly arranged hydrogen ions. Then I am going to put down under a strong magnetic field where they reach an equilibrium state where they are equally arranged, horizontally arranged according to the poles of the magnet. Then what I do is that I suddenly give a radio frequency wave, which means to say I am creating an electromagnetic radiation. Now, due to this response to the electromagnetic radiation, due to the response to this RF radio frequency, all the ones that are longitudinally arranged becomes horizontally arranged. The longitudinal hydrogen atoms becomes transverse or longitudinally arranged. So such one will actually give me one kind of image. Then what I actually do is that I try to remove off that radio frequency, electromagnetic radiation. I stop the radiation. Then what happens is that when there is a sudden loss of the radio frequency, some, depending on their capacities, some cells either lose energy or some cells either gain energy. And also at the same point of time, they either rotate in their axes or either they rotate on their planes. Okay, it is difficult. I know this is difficult, but just understand they either rotate horizontally or vertically, or either they lose energy or gain energy. So depending on such things, I will be getting different images. I will be getting different images. So such things are actually called as sequences. Okay, such things are actually called as sequences. So let me recall overall once again, hydrogen atoms or hydrogen protons are the ones that are responsible, the main ions that are responsible for imaging of MR. Then when the randomly arranged hydrogen atoms are placed within a strong magnetic field, they are longitudinally aligned. And after that, when I give a radio frequency wave which releases an electromagnetic radiation, then the longitudinally arranged hydrogen ions now become arranged transversely. And after that, what I do is that I remove off the electromagnetic radiation or I remove the radio frequency. Depending on their individual properties, the hydrogen atoms that are present in different cells, either they lose energy or they gain energy and start to rotate or spin within their planes. So such kind will give you different kinds of images. Okay. Now, the first image actually that is being acquired in an MR image is called as a T1 weighted imaging. Okay. T1WI. We call it as T1WI or T1 image. So what happens here? When the proton releases energy into the surrounding lattice, okay? When the proton releases energy into the surrounding lattice, the energy has been gained by a radio frequency coil, and now they are releasing that energy into the surrounding area. So such kind of thing actually produces a T1 image of an MRI, okay? Then, when the proton releases energy and spins and loses energy. Okay, proton releases energy and it spins. That thing is actually called as T2 image. So T1 relaxation and T2 relaxation is that all the cells has to come back down into their original position when present down within a magnetic field. Either they lose energy, and either if this energy is being released down into the surrounding lattice, and the time taken from that radio frequency time, removal of radio frequency to the arrangement back into their normal position is called as T1 relaxation, which produces an image called as a T1WI. Clear or no? I know it is difficult. I know it is very, very difficult for you guys to understand. But still, just remember one thing. When a proton releases energy into the surrounding lattice, and the time taken for it to relax back into the normal equilibrium is called as a T1 relaxation, which produces an image called as a T1 weighted image. Then, if the proton releases energy into surrounding spin and they start to spin, it is called as a spin-spin relaxation, and it produces a T2 weighted image. The main ion that is responsible for developing of images on NMR is hydrogen. The thing is that the first, in the absence of magnetic field, all protons have random movement. But when they are placed under the influence of a magnetic field, alignment of the proton takes place. They are aligned longitudinally. Then realignment of ions occurs horizontally when there is a presence of a radio frequency pulse. Then I suddenly remove the radio frequency pulse. I switch off the radio frequency pulse, and the atoms try to return to their original position either by releasing energy or gaining energy. When they release that energy into the surrounding lattice, and time taken for that to relax back into original position is called as T1 relaxation time, and that is the one that is actually producing T1 image. When the proton releases energy into the surrounding spin, it is called as a spin-spin relaxation, and that is the one that is actually producing T2 weighted imaging. Simple. Okay, is this clear now? Yes or no? Right? Lattice is the sense. Lattice is something that orientation. Okay, how can I say? Let me show you the image. You can actually understand. Lattice is nothing but its plane. Okay? Lattice is nothing but its plane, either horizontal plane, axis, okay, x, y, z axis. Either the speed is happening in x axis, y axis, or z axis, so that is the lattice, right? Clear? Lattice is in the plane, okay? In whatever the plane, either x axis, y axis, or z axis, it is the plane. Lattice is nothing but a plane, okay? Right. Yes or no? No, it is present inside your body. It is present inside your water, in the form of water. Hydrogen ions are present within the water, right? H2O. H2O has got two hydrogens in it and one oxygen, right? So that hydrogen you are actually using. And every soft tissue, why MRI is much more, why it is much more used, why it is soft tissue orientation is better for an MR imaging, is that because you see here, all the soft tissues, all the fatty areas has got a lot of water in them. So if I'm trying to control the movement of water, if I'm trying to control the magnetic fields around the water, and if I'm trying to move their positions, if I'm changing their positions, let us say if there is a gain of water or if it is a loss of water inside the body, I'm trying to analyze and I'm trying to get images. Now let me ask you a very, very simple question. What is accumulation of water inside your body called as? What is your accumulation of water inside body called as? Accumulation of water, edema, perfect. So can you tell me what are the, any kind of a disease or any kind of a clinical conditions which have got edema in it? Renal failure, technically, yes, okay. Meningitis, see, meningitis actually, see, edema is technically, okay, renal failure, yes, it is also good. Yes, heart failure is also good. Nephritis is also good. Okay, then pulmonary congestion, perfect. Nephritis. Then what else? Meningitis, cerebral edema, skin edema, pitting edema, okay. Cerebral edema, hypertension. See, for all liver conditions, see, now you are talking here. A lot of conditions. So now for analyzing all such kind of diseases, and particularly speaking, I have got more kind of free flowing fluid in the brain, and I have got a lot of hydrogen movement. It is happening inside the brain, and that is the reason also MR is the one that is must first investigation of choice that is utilized for the brain. So cerebral edema can be very well diagnosed out in the brain. But logically speaking, yes, all the conditions, whatever you have still, like a congestive heart failures or liver failures or nephritis and other conditions also, yes, you can use MRI, but still investigations, research and have been going on for different utilization of MRI into the edematic studies. Because the logic is that because of the movement of the hydrogen ions inside the body produces different images. I am trying to utilize this MR imaging. Okay, but still it is research is going on, but MRI has got a better orientation towards the brain cells. Now let me tell you a very good example. Okay, that's it. That is what about MRI. But the biggest problem here on MRI is that it takes a lot of time than the CT. Where CT can be taken down within 5 to 10 seconds, MRI investigation generally takes almost about 40 minutes, half an hour to 45 minutes, because a lot of sequences has to be taken, right? That is what you understand at this level. When we are trying to deal about the central nervous system, I will get into more details and more depth and more sequences, how they are applied. Even right now, if I tell, it will be much more confusing. Just understand what is a T1 image and a T2 image right now. Later, I will give you more idea about the other sequences also, okay? And how the images looks like. First, let us try to understand the basic densities. This is the last one. It takes the last 10 minutes and I'm done with the class today. Okay. First, now we came to understand about all the things. Now, let me show you some images and let us try to analyze those images. See here. Okay, now we have, see here, better all the investigations that are accumulated here. Now look at this thing here. Sorry, I think I'm sharing some other things. Okay, right. So now you see here, let us try to observe all the things that we have learned now together and try to interpret them in the form of diseases. Okay, the first thing, anything that looks white on an X-ray is called as radio opaque. It is called as a radio opacity. Opacity means to say solid structure, and it is actually looking down on X-ray. So that is the reason any kind of a tissue that looks white and dense on an X-ray is called as a radio opaque shadow. And if it is looking black, it is called as a radiolucent shadow. Okay. Anything, any kind of a tissue that looks black is called as a radiolucent shadow. So air looks radiolucent. Soft tissues like heart looks radio opaque. Now look at here, bones. You can see here the bones looks radio opaque. And the surrounding air is looking black. So this is radiolucent. Now you see here, the air that is present inside the lungs is radiolucent, and the metal that is present in the humerus is looking technically white. So this is radio opacity, radiolucency. So that is how I am describing my shadows here. The radiolucency that is present over the lungs, the radio opacity that is present over the humerus. So these are the basic shadows that are present on an X-ray. And the same way, I am telling if it is looking, what is looking on white is called as a density on a CT scan. So if it's something that is looking much more whiter on a CT scan, I call such kind of shadow as hyperdense shadow. And if it is something that is looking gray to black on a CT scan, I call it as hypodense shadow. Look at these images that are present down here. I have got an axial view of the brain, which is showing a circular hyperdense shadow that is present along the thalamic region of the brain, obliterating the angle of the lateral geniculate body. Okay. Forget about it, but it is complicated. Okay, if I'm trying to talk about the disease, but you see here, can you see here a round oval density that is present near the thalamus, right? So this is a hyperdense shadow which is looking completely white. Actually, this whiteness is actually happening in this patient because of the blood. So this condition is an intracranial hematoma. Which is happening in the left thalamus, okay, inside the left thalamus. And this is actually a bleed from middle meningeal artery, okay. You will learn that in neuroradiology, but still understand here, this white thing that is looking here is the blood, which is the bleeding that is happening because of the rupture from the middle meningeal artery. Next, you see here, there is a big gray shadow that is present inside the liver. And what technically looks gray on an CT or an X-ray? Fluid is the one that looks very, very gray. So what is the accumulation of a fluid within a organ called as? It is not edema. Edema is accumulation of fluid within a cell. Ascites, okay. Ascites is happening actually between a cavity. Effusions are actually happening along the diffusion membranes. Any kind of collection of fluid within an organ is called as cyst. So now what we are looking here is a hepatic cyst. Okay. There is a lot of fluid with a complete membrane that is present outside. It is present inside the right lobe of the liver. So it is a big hepatic cyst. Okay. Then here I am looking at the endoscopic imaging. I am looking at the white endoscope that is present here, and I am completely visualizing the biliary tree here. See, so this is a fluoroscopic technique, which is an endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography. I am trying to visualize the complete biliary tree. When you observe very, very closely, let me zoom in here. When you observe closely, you see here there is a thin black line where the contrast material is not being filled up, right? There is a thin line where the contrast material is not being filled up. So this one you can actually call, what is the blackness on an X-ray called as? Lucency, right? There is a linear straight line like lucency that is present along the biliary tree. the description how I made is there is a renier lucency that is present along the hepatic bile duct, and this one is actually happening because of a clinical condition called as ascariasis. Okay, ascariasis is a parasitic infection where the ascariasis lumbricoides parasite is being invaded down into the biliary tree, and that one is actually showing up as a radiolucent shadow within the biliary tree. So when I done an endoscopic retrograde imaging, I see a linear lucent shadow that is present down here, which actually indicates. Now let us try to make the same kind of investigation, and I try to make an ultrasound image on this person. You see, can you see the parasite very clearly here? But that is actually present down within the gallbladder though, right? So the same investigation can be done. Either it's my choice, either it's the doctor's choice to prescribe an ultrasound, or either to prescribe an ERCP. ERCP is much more invasive, long time, painful. Ultrasound is simple, bedside, and fast. Okay, so yes, different diseases can be done on the different kinds of investigation, doesn't matter. Now you see here, for the same patient where I have done an ERCP, I have done an MRCP. But you see here, there is again a black shadow that is coming down within the biliary tree itself here, right? So the shadow that is shown on an MRI, we call it as something that is looking as white, we call it as hyperintensity, and which is looking black is called as hypointensity. Okay, remember this, that something that looks white on an MRI image is called as hyperintensity. The something that looks black to gray is called as hypointensity. Look at this image here. You see here something, there is a round, well circumscribed round intensity, hyper intensity that is present down in the prefrontal cortex. Okay, it is present in the frontal lobe of the brain. See here, it is a hyper intense shadow that is present down in the prefrontal cortex. On the other sequence of the MRI, I can see the same area is now hypointense. You see here, hypointense. This hyperintense, it became hyperintense on one sequence. This is the T1 sequence. And on the T2 sequence, you see here that the same lesion or the same pathology became black. But you see here, the surrounding structures became much more whiter. So which one actually being accumulated here and shows whiter, and there is a fluid that is coming around, it means to say the edema that is present around here. So the whiteness that I am looking in this sequence is the edema. So which means to say there is a lot of edema that is happening because of this tumor. That is how I understood this image. Okay, here in this image, on the first sequence when I took a T1 image, it became a hyper intense signal. Then it slowly became a hypointense signal. Then finally, there is a lot of fluid that is present here, which is again became a hyperintense signal. So which logically suggests me this clinical condition, such kind of characteristic feature actually happens in a condition called as neurosarcoidosis. Okay. Okay, the condition is a neurosarcoidosis. So the condition, the patient I am looking at here is suffering from neurosarcoidosis. Yes, both T1 and T2 images have been obtained here. Yes, the first one is T1. Okay, see, let us not try to get into more detail in today's class for the differences between T1 and T2 images. I will teach them more when we get down into the neuroradiology, because it will confuse a lot. First, try to understand the basic densities on conventional radiography, which is much more easier. If I'm talking about T1 and T2, I know it will get more and more complicated and it will confuse you more. Okay, right? But in the same patient, I have But in the same patient, I have taken down a CT scan. So what is the difference between a CT scan? CT scan, the bones look white. And actually, in this MRI scan, the soft tissues look white, depending on the sequence, okay? The fluid looks black or white. Okay, the fluid looks white on T2. The fluid looks black on T1. Okay? Remember one thing here. The fluid looks black on T1. The fluid looks white on T2. So, white, fluid, and T2. How can I remember this? As World War II. White, water, which is looking on T2 image only. So fluid looks white on T2. How can I differentiate here? Yes, I can see the ventricles here. Ventricles have got CSF in them. And CSF is a fluid. Fluid is nothing but water. Water is looking white. So the image I am looking here is a T2 image. So this one becomes T1 image. Did you understand what exactly is the difference between a T1 image and a T2 image now? Fluid looks black on a T1 image and fluid looks white on a T2 image. Then, how can I remember it? World War II. Water appears white on T2. Now, imagine if the same kind of patient, I have taken a CT scan. You look here, there is a hyperdensity with a hypodensity that is present between. Okay, there is a well circumscribed mass. Let me zoom in. There is a well circumscribed mass with a hypodensity that is present here. Hyperdensity on the outside and hypodensity in the middle. So which means to say, I'm talking about again neurosarcoidosis. Now, after treatment, you see here in the T1 image, this image became completely hypo-intense now and a lot of surrounding hyper-intensity. But you see here the edema is completely lost. So by this, I can understand the progression of the disease. Okay, either the disease has been cured or either the disease has not been cured. So that is how I actually use MR imaging for the also analyzing the progression of the disease. Now look at this image very carefully. The previous patient where we have done the ERCP, I'm looking at a gallbladder, I'm looking at the common bile duct, where you see here, there the fluid, bile is nothing but fluid, fluid is nothing but water, water is nothing but it has to look white. And now, rather than looking white, there is a streak or a line like hypo-intense signal along the bile duct. So hypo-intense streak-like intensity that is shown along the bile duct again indicates a condition called as ascariasis. Now you see here, doesn't matter whatever the investigation I use, I should be utilize the principle of the modality I have done and I have come down to the same conclusion. So doesn't matter even if I do the X-ray, doesn't matter if I do the CT, doesn't matter if I do the MRI, I should be able to do the same kind of diagnosis. So logically speaking, as MBBS graduates, what we need to understand here is that which investigation is better for which kind of disease. You will be learning slowly when we go down into the systemic pathology. Systemic imaging, we'll go down to the respiratory system for the next coming few days. So I will tell whenever which is necessary, I will explain those things slowly and slowly. So these are the images. Clear? Yes or no? Let me recover back. Hyper radio opaque shadow of the bones. Radiolucency of the lungs. Hyperdensity that is present down. Hyperdensity that is present on a CT. Hypodensity that is present down on a liver. Right? Hyper intense signal that is present down in the frontal cortex. hypo-intense signal that is present down on a T2 image in the frontal cortex. Hyperdensity shadow with the central hypodensity that is present down in the frontal region of the brain. So this is a CT. And heterogeneous intense signal, heterogeneous intense signal that is present down on an MR. Hypo intense signal that is present down along the hepatic duct. Hypodense translucence or hypodensity or translucency that is present down along the biliary tree. So that is how you are describing the lesions, and the lesions actually depending on their capacities, tissue susceptibility factors or the radiation quality factors, they show different densities. So such kind of density is called as a natural contrast. The tissue differences densities that happens among the all the tissues is called as a natural contrast. Okay, for only those things where I cannot give or where I cannot view the organs which does not have any kind of we are done with the class, that's it. We are done with the class, I guess, almost. We are done with the complete imaging characteristics of basic modalities. I have completed all basic modalities, all basic densities. Okay, don't worry. So that's it. Now, for how the different lesions